But it's Eric Sachs over at Breakthrough Broker. Super, super excited today to be hosting one of my best friends in the industry and someone I look up to as I travel and get to speak with different speakers throughout America. This Sean is one of the best I've seen, one of the best people in the industry. So Sean, thank you so much today for coming. We're going to be talking about some certain mindsets. I love this presentation. I'm so excited for you guys to hear it. Little house cleaning for those of you new to a Breakthrough Broker webinar. Yes, this is being recorded. I'll say it again. Yes, this is being recorded. We will get this out to you guys this afternoon. So if you've registered for the event, you're going to get the recording this afternoon. We will also be answering questions. So Sean's going to get through his presentation, and we are going to leave time for questions as he talks about his ideas and strategies and the mindset he wants to discuss with you guys today. So without further ado, and he's going to tell you a little bit about himself, one of my best friends in the industry, someone I look up to. And so Sean, thanks for being on with us today.
No problem, Eric. Certainly, I'm thrilled to be here.
I'm going to switch over to presenter mode to you and you guys. Also, guys, while I'm switching to presenter mode, if you're having trouble with your audio, please, please, please check your connections. I'm showing right now that our audio is working, and we checked Sean's audio, and it was great when we got started. So, Sean, I see your screen, and we're ready to rock and roll.
Fantastic, Eric. Well, certainly, I'm excited to be here, and thanks for everybody who's taking time out of their Friday to kick off their weekend. We got a big sports weekend ahead. We got the World Series tonight. We got college football. NFL's in full swing. Hockey started. Basketball started. Man, Eric, as sports fans like you and I know we are, what a fun time to be engaged. And so I thought this was a perfect time to talk about getting in the game, how to score big in real estate and have a ball doing it. Let me quickly introduce myself so people know who I am and my background. My very first paycheck that I got was in the food service business. I was a waiter and a bartender. I worked my way through college at University of Florida. After college, I became a golf pro. I worked at a big resort course in Brooksville, Florida, and then a private club in Cleveland, Ohio. And then I moved back to Columbus, where I became a beer salesman. I worked for the Miller and Coors distributor here in Central Ohio. And, you know, Eric, I thought to myself when I decided it was time for me to grow up and get a real job, I said to myself, what would be a job that would allow me to drink beer and play golf? So I got into real estate, and I've been a licensed agent since 1998. I sold actively as an agent for about 4.5 years, had the chance to become a branch manager, and I took on that responsibility because I love the leadership opportunities and really a chance to still be in sales, but I was more selling the company, the office, the industry. I love the coaching and training part of it, but I kind of hated the managing part of it. So my company named me the director of training for the Cole Banker Company in Columbus and Cincinnati. And I was in charge of all of that, all of the training for about 1,400 agents. I started speaking at national conferences, and I really enjoyed that. And so after about 13 years as the director of agent development, I decided to jump back into sales a few years ago and take my speaking on a little more of a national level. So I opened up my own company called Sean Speaks, and I've been blogging for over 10 years. And so I'm going to gather some of the stuff that I've learned over those 20 plus years in real estate and share with your listeners today. Okay.
Sounds great. We look forward to it.
Well, let me tell you my philosophy, because I think the listeners need to understand where I come from. Cause I, as in all those roles as an agent, manager, director of training, and now back as an agent and speaker and blogger, I think real estate's about three things. It's about building relationships. It's about solving problems, and it's about having fun. Now think about those three things we just talked about: build relationships, solve problems, and have fun. If every single day you can focus on building relationships, either a new relationship with someone that you've never met or deepen a relationship with someone that you've known for years, if you can help people solve their problems, and if you can have fun doing it, I just think that's a good way to go through life, Eric. So when I lay my head on the pillow at the end of the day, I ask myself, did I build relationships today? Did I solve problems today? And did I have fun today? And usually if I can answer yes to those three things, I find that everything else takes care of itself. So especially to the newer agents on the call today, I want you guys to focus on those three things. Focus on building relationships, solving problems, and having fun. And the contracts and the closings, I promise you, will take care of themselves. So I want to encourage you guys. I know you're on your laptop or desktop now, but grab your mobile phones and start sharing some of the things you're learning today. Start sharing some of the ideas, the concepts, the slides. Make sure you use the hashtag #GetInTheGame. And you can also follow me on Instagram and Twitter at Sean Karp. And you can also follow at Breakthrough Broker on Instagram as well. So, Eric, without further ado, let's get in the game, okay?
Let's do it.
All right, here we go. Obviously, a lot of people have seen this slide before. It's one of my favorites because whether you're an athlete, whether you are in sales, whether you are in any type of business for yourself, we all get caught in our comfort zone. And we want to break through that wall to get to where the magic happens. And it looks like such a small jump, but we know it's such a chasm between where we're comfortable and where the magic happens. And so we think about these belief boundaries that we put on ourselves. And I want you to picture for a second, Eric, let's imagine this is where we are right now. Regardless of where we're at in our career, whether we're a manager, an agent, leader of a team, part of a team, whether in mortgage or title or whatever other industry you might be listening, we all have this belief boundary we create around ourselves. And this might say, this is the amount of money we believe we should be making right now. And maybe this represents the neighborhood we live in. And this represents the kind of car we drive right now. And this represents the where our kids go to school. And here's our vacation spot. And here's the kind of clothes we wear. Well, what happens, Eric, is we create this belief boundary around where we are in our life right now that says, this is who I am and this is where I belong to be. And all of our actions and all of our feelings and all of our behaviors and all of our abilities then stay stuck within that belief boundary. Well, here's my challenge to the people in the room here. What happens if in 2020 we say, I really believe I can double my income. I can make six figures. I can make $500,000, whatever it might be. So let's say we somehow next year, something happens and we make double our income. But what happens to our belief boundary? The whole thing expands. Because if we're making double our income, we can drive a new car. We can live in the gated community. We can go on 3 weeks of vacations. But until we believe we can do that, until we really expand our beliefs, it's probably not going to happen. So with that being kind of the basis of what we're talking about, we have to understand that to get to the gold medal stand in sports, to get to the top of the top level of our industry, I love this quote from the late great Bears manager, George Halas. Nobody who ever gave their best ever regretted it. And as we get to the end of the year and we start finishing up 2019 and starting to look ahead to 2020, I bet there's a lot of people on this call that can look back and realize that they didn't really give their best at times this year. And I want everyone to be committed to give their best. These four girls, imagine when they got in the swimming pool early in the mornings. Imagine these four girls when they had to skip their prom and had to do homework in the van because they were committed to win the gold medal for their country. You know, they truly believed they could get to the medal stand, and not just the medal stand, to the gold medal stand, to be the best in the world. And so it's going to take direction. It's going to take someone to get us there. And what it really boils down to, Eric, and you know as a sports fan, is the accountability you're going to get. Some people love a coach that's going to hold them accountable. Other people like what's called a player's coach. We see a lot more of the professional athletes preferring to have a player's coach, someone who's just going to be there to guide them but not demand anything of them. So I want to start talking about accountability before we talk about the sports individually. And we need to hold ourselves accountable in real estate. Most people listening to this call, they're independent contractors, which means they work for themselves. They work with a broker, but they work for themselves. And so how do you hold yourself accountable? Well, this is a book that this isn't on my suggested reading list, Eric, but it's a book that I read when I was building a presentation one time, and it had a really cool concept in it that talked about the difference between activity and results. And I just want to take a second to kind of dive into these. Activity are actions people take that lead to results. Now, the authors define results then as the desired or undesired outcomes that result from taking action, or as you can see in parentheses there, not taking action.
Yep.
Okay. So with that definition, these authors then posit that there's what's called a results pyramid. And this results pyramid, the foundation of the pyramid is the experiences we have in our lives. And our experiences impact the beliefs that we have. The beliefs we have impact the actions we take. And the actions we take give us the results that we get. Makes total sense, doesn't it? Our experiences create the foundation of our lives. That causes us to believe certain things. Based on what we believe, we take certain actions, and the actions deliver us results. Now, all of the results we get are either measurable, memorable, or meaningful. Some results are all three, some results are two, some results are just one, but everything ties into those letters. So let's review. If activity are actions people take that lead to results, and results are the desired or undesired outcomes that result from taking action or not taking action, and that part's really critical, Eric. I know you're a music fan. You've heard of the band Rush from Canada, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they have a great song called Free Will. And in that song, it says, if you choose not to decide, you still have made a choice. And so understand, you guys, that sometimes not taking action in our business, not following up with an open house guest, not knocking on a FSBO's door, not following up with a lead from an internet source. That's going to cause a result just as much as doing something will. And so the question I want to pose to the viewers is, what do you guys need to start doing in 2020? Or what do you need to stop doing in 2020 to achieve the results that you want in your real estate career? Because holding yourself accountable to do that is going to be critical. So if our experiences lead to our beliefs, lead to the actions, lead to the results, then somewhere here, Eric, between the actions we take and the results we get is our culture. And when I say our culture, I don't mean your brand or your brokerage or the industry even. I mean your individual culture. Eric Sachs, Inc., Sean Carpenter, Inc. Everything that I do gets me to where I want to be. So if I'm looking for new or better results, I'm going to have to change my culture. Because a lot of people are like this diagram on the left. Their experiences are constantly changing, so therefore their beliefs are always going in different directions. Their beliefs cause their actions to be
We lost you for a second, Sean. Are you there?
Different every time.
Sean, are you there?
I'm here, Eric.
We lost you
I'm still here.
We lost you for about 10 seconds.
Okay. All right. Do you hear me now?
Yep. We hear you great.
Okay, good. So let me just, I'll pick up right here, you know, and you can see in the diagram there that obviously we want to be focused on the exact same thing. So for me, I'm kind of on the right. At least I try to be. I build relationships, I solve problems, and I have fun. If everything I do is focused on those things, then I should get to where I want to be. Now, you can see it says either you manage your culture, or it will manage you. And it's really important that we understand that, because we want to be in alignment. Eric, I'm sure out in Colorado where you live, beautiful state of Colorado, you see people rowing, a lot of kayaking out there, a lot of double kayaks. But here in the Midwest, where I live in Ohio, a lot of crew teams race on the rivers. And you know, it's funny when you watch those boats, the more in alignment the racers are, the faster and the straighter the boat goes, right?
Right.
And so the authors of the book had a second book that came out, and it talked about complement versus complete alignment. See, the authors said basically complement is when you get people to do the job, when they just do the job that they were assigned to do. Complete alignment is when they understand why they're doing the job they've been assigned to do. And I think in real estate, in sales, in a relationship-driven business like ours, a lot of us do the complement well. We can fill out contracts and we can put lockboxes on doors and we can put signs in yards. But when we're in complete alignment with what we're trying to get in our business, it's the difference between hands and feet and heart and mind. See, hands and feet is when the person at the assembly line stands there all day and puts the widget on the piece as it goes by. When you include your heart and mind into it and you understand why you're putting a piece on that thing as it drives by, it makes a huge difference. And so in sports, Eric, I can put, you know, four amazing athletes up here. Tim Tebow could understand the X's and O's of the game, but his passion with his head and his heart brought him to an entirely another level. Two national championships, Heisman Trophy. Serena Williams, every single time she steps on the court, she can execute with her hands and her feet. But when her head and her heart are in the game, we're watching an amazing World Series right now. The game three is tonight as we're recording this. You know, Jose Altuve from the Houston Astros can get his feet in the right position at second base. He can get his feet and his hands in the right position when he's batting, but when his head and his heart are in it. And certainly the U.S. women's soccer team was fun to watch and what they were doing. So you can see how impactful it is to make sure that the activities and the results you're focused on are all based on the culture you're creating around your business. Now let's move to the schedule, Eric, because obviously the sports season is built around the schedules. You're out there in Colorado where you're one of those rare cities in America that has four teams, baseball, football, basketball, and hockey. And so obviously you can imagine how important scheduling is for the Rockies, the Nuggets, the Broncos, and the Avalanche, right? And so they need to make sure that they're not double booking the arena. They also do circuses and trade shows and events and conventions. And so it's important in our business then that we build our business around our schedule. Now, what you're seeing there on the screen, Eric, is this is a sample schedule that I used to use with my agents when I was a manager, and I still kind of build my business around this very simple schedule. Now, this isn't a three-week month, Eric. Think of it as the top row is your mornings, The middle row is your afternoons, and the bottom row is your evenings. And so if we build our schedule and put importance around our schedule, then we have a better chance of success. And I've said for a long time, either you control your schedule or somebody else does. And in fact, Eric, here's something I say to a lot of new agents when they're starting to build their schedule is live your life and let real estate happen in the cracks. Eric, look, you and I know way too many people in our years and years and years in the business and traveling around the country that we've met that live real estate and fit their life in the cracks. Is that fair to say? They live real estate and fit their life in the cracks.
Oh, yeah.
And usually they end up failing at both because they're so focused on their business, they're not spending time with their family, with their kids, with their parents when they're alive, their health, their spiritual nature. And so I think when you start focusing on your business and live your life and fit real estate in the cracks, you'll find some success. So here's an example of what I would suggest a business schedule looks like. Now you notice I just used to put showing up for the meetings to our agents. That was the only thing I put in there, but look at how much open time they have during the week. So I'm going to start suggesting you build your business around your life and fit your business in the cracks. So let's just say you go to church, house of worship, temple, synagogue on Sunday. Maybe you play poker with your buddies on Wednesday nights. Maybe you want to go see your daughter's soccer games on Saturdays. Let's go ahead and put those in the schedule first. Now look at how much time I still have to do stuff. Look at how much time I still have to run my business. And this is where, Eric, I'm gonna show you where you can start building your business. And I'm gonna say this word a couple times because I want people to write it down. On purpose. On purpose. Use a hashtag if you want. Make that your theme for 2020. Hashtag on purpose. I want to see people be successful on purpose, not by accident. I think too many people in our industry, they're successful by accident and they can't repeat that year in and year out. But when you're successful on purpose, you can take it to the next level. So on purpose, maybe you're going to say, you know what, Sunday afternoons, I'm going to hold open houses. And then I'm going to, on purpose, work with buyers on Mondays, Tuesdays, in the evenings, Thursday, late afternoons, and Saturday mornings. Now, why would I do that? Because when I meet a client at an open house or a potential client at the open house, Eric, and they say, well, this house isn't going to work for me. And I say, well, look, I'm available on Monday or Tuesday night to show you other houses. Do either of those days work for you? If you say, well, how about Wednesday night? I say, sorry, Eric, I'm already booked on Wednesday. So it sounds like Monday and Tuesday night don't work for you. Is that right? Well, how about Thursday afternoon? See, I'm on purpose trying to fit my buyers into my schedule the same way a doctor or dentist fits a client in when they need a root canal. If you call your dentist right now, Eric, and said, I need to get a root canal, they'll say, we schedule those on Fridays. The next Friday we have available is November 10th, right? They do things on purpose. And so I can control my schedule. Maybe I'm going to say I'll work with sellers to do listing presentations late afternoons on Tuesdays and Wednesdays. I'll hold Thursday nights open for my listings and Friday mornings for the people that can meet during the day. But look at how much time that I still have to fit my business in around the things that I've scheduled on purpose. Now, of course, Eric, people are probably thinking like, well, what if you have a seller who can only meet on Tuesday night? Well, then if I don't already have a buyer on Tuesday night, I can do a listing appointment on Tuesday night because I was trying to do business on Tuesday night. If a buyer wants to see a house on Tuesday afternoon and I don't have a listing appointment, then I can squeeze the buyer in. But I want to reserve those blank spots for my business. And then clearly I'm going to build in time for my business development every day. And that's going to happen earlier rather than later. So that's, I think, really important that we really manage our schedule to hold that up. And now look, even as full as that schedule looks, look at how much time I still have to do stuff, showings and marketing and webinars and coaching and all my personal stuff, getting my oil changed and grocery shopping and all those things. But I find that if you control your schedule, instead of letting other people do it, you'll find more success. Eric, you travel around the country a lot. You know, one of the biggest challenges people have is holding to their schedule. Is that right?
Absolutely. And I think one of the biggest challenges is that if you're not doing this, it becomes a whirlwind. And you're not able to track what you're doing, see where you're going. So I love this.
Yeah. And, you know, I think a lot of people say, well, you have to be available whenever your clients need you. And while I agree that the best level of service is to be available 24/7, I don't think that's realistic. And I think if you control your schedule and work with the right people and set the right expectations, you still will have some leeway to drop and do things as needed. But not every single thing is urgent and important. And we need to start protecting our own business and our own schedule and understand that not everything is urgent and important. In fact, very few things in life are urgent and important. And so this really gives you a good idea.
Also, to point out too, and you probably hear a ton of this. I hear a ton of, Oh my gosh, I'm so busy. Or you get home at night and your spouse says to you, your significant other is like, how was today? Oh my gosh, we were so busy. But if you really look at the busyness, you don't have something like this to look at, your busyness doesn't mean productivity. And so you're placing on purpose productive time frames in your schedule when you're doing something like this. So I like this.
Love it. All right, now that we got our schedule, let's talk about our fans. Because without our fans, sports wouldn't exist, right? And so I love this quote from the great book by Bob Berg called The Go-Giver. It says, your network is your safety net and your fishing net. It will save your life and feed you for life if you build it well and treat it right. What a great metaphor that it's going to protect us and feed us if we take care of it. So how can we build what I call a cult-like following, right? Like the Cameron Crazies there at Duke. How do we build a following that no matter what, they're going to be behind us? Well, what is a cult-like following? A cult-like following, Eric, is when people know you, when they like you, and when they trust you. But you and I both know, Eric, the knowing part and the liking part is super easy, isn't it? It's the trusting part that becomes so, so, so critical. Look, everybody on this call has friends of theirs that they know and they like, but they wouldn't trust when it comes to the financial advice. Everyone on this call has friends that they know and they like, but they wouldn't trust when it comes to parenting advice. You know people, you like people, but you wouldn't trust them when it comes to dating advice. So it's very possible, especially to the newer agents on the call, that your friends know you and like you, but they just don't trust you yet when it comes to real estate because they've never seen you sell a house in the neighborhood, in this price point, in this part of town. And so how can you start earning that critical, critical trust from your audience, your fan base? Well, I think there's three C's, Eric, that lead your fans to trust you. And I want to share those with you right now, because when you start thinking about these three C's, everyone on this webinar can start focusing on these three every single day. The first C of trust is competence. Competence. How good are you at what you do? And that's a function of ability. Do you know your stuff? Do you know how the contracts work and the lockboxes work? And you know how to show houses? You know how to do all the negotiations? That's competence. The second C that earns trust is confidence. And confidence is really a function of attitude, because people can feel your confidence. People can hear your confidence. People can sense your confidence. And the third C, I think, is the most important one when it comes to trust. I've had people tell me,
Sean, we lost you for a second, buddy. Sean, you there?
It's not important at all. And that's
Sean,
I'm still here.
We lost you. You went a little digital and
I'm
quiet
here.
On consistency. Consistency.
Okay. So it sounds like I'm back. So I apologize. I'm not sure what's happening with the system here, Eric. But consistency, I think, is one
You're
of the
back.
Most important ones, right? And that's a function of action, right? And so think about our business, Eric, with consistency. We only work with customers once every sometimes 3 to 7 to really 11 years. That's the number right now from the National Association of Realtors is the 11 years between purchase and sale. And so we have to be consistent in our marketing. We have to be consistent in our follow-up. We have to be consistent in our pop-bys and in our visits and our client appreciation events. And that's how we can start earning trust. When you can have more competence, confidence, and consistency, people will start thinking of you as their realtor. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I love it. You know, I teach a class called How to Be the One Realtor Your Friends Choose When They Know 10 Others, which is exactly what you're building here, because, you know, everyone knows 10 real estate agents in every market at least, right? And I love this, you know, competence, confidence, and consistency. And I also agree, because if you're not consistent in the first two or consistent in your actions amongst your sphere of influence, you can't build that trust. So I love that you focus on consistency as being one of the main features of that.
Yep, no doubt. So let's talk some sports. Let's talk a little bit about soccer. I know there's some soccer fans probably listening in. Soccer really, I know as many people follow it in the world, but here in the United States, it hasn't caught on as much. And I think part of the reason why is because a lot of times the game's being played backwards. A lot of the game of soccer is the ball going opposite direction. And the reason why that happens is so that the players can survey the field and see where the best path is to get to their goals. So in real estate, we have to sometimes look at our past before we can go forward. In fact, they say the best indication of future behavior is past behavior. So I want to share this little diagram, Eric. This is a sample, really simple spreadsheet that I used my entire career. I still use to this day. After my next closing, I'll open up this document. I'll scroll to the bottom and I'll add in my client's name, the subdivision if they're in one, the property address, the closing date, how I got the business. And you can see there sphere, floor duty I, open house FU. That means floor duty immediate. And that means open house was a follow-up, not open house FU. That means open house follow-up. And so, and then I, if it's a listing in yellow there, the days on the market, the list of sell price ratio, and my sales price. So I knew what my average sales price was to the second. I know what my average days on the market is to the second. But that's not enough. I need to learn, where does my business come from? So look at my, this is the first time I was in sales before I got back in a few years ago. Look, only 17% of my business comes in the first quarter, based on my history. And so I know that if I've set a goal for 2020 to do, let's say, Eric, 100 transactions, that based on my past experience, I should have about 18 deals in the first quarter. If I'm past that, then I'm ahead of schedule. If I'm behind that, then I'm behind my typical schedule. I also know where my business comes from. So I really want to encourage people listening to this. You need to break down your business to where it is, where it's coming from, and how you're getting it, because when you start breaking those things down, it'll really help you understand where to spend your time, effort, and money. Because look at this, 65% of my business comes from my sphere of influence. And so it's important that I know that I should, if I want to increase that, I'm going to have to spend more time, effort, and money there. If I want to do internet leads or open houses or whatever I want to do, you got to look backwards sometimes to go forwards. Now let's talk about hockey. Eric, I know you're excited. Your Central Division leading Colorado Avalanche off to a great start out there. I know the town's probably electric with their start. And if I think if you're going to take a lesson from hockey and relate it to real estate, I think you got to go to the greatest player ever, and that's Wayne Gretzky. And that, you know, famous quote from Wayne Gretzky, when they asked, how does he score so many goals? He says, I don't skate to where the puck's going. I skate to where the puck's going, not to where it's been. And so the lesson from hockey for those of us listening is, where's our market changing? Where's the market going so we can get ahead of it and not follow behind it? Look, a few years ago, we had short sales and bank-owned houses and foreclosures, and a lot of the people in our industry were way behind that. We knew it was coming, but we still didn't educate ourselves on what the process was and how do we service that. Another way that our market's changing constantly is with technology. I mean, it's only been 11 years, but the iPhone is constantly changing. Galaxies are constantly changing. Everything's mobile now. What's happening next in our business? With your brokers, with your brands, with your local boards of realtors, your state associations, the national association, start listening, reading the materials they're sending out. What's the industry doing? Eric, you at Breakthrough Broker, you guys do such a great job of constantly updating and evolving your materials for your audience. And I love that because, look, we've got a whole new thing called iBuyers, and we've got, you know, augmented reality and virtual reality and all these different things that are changing the way we do things. We've got to skate to where the puck is going, not to where the puck was. And let's obviously hit on goals. You couldn't talk about sports. You couldn't talk about success in real estate if you weren't going to talk about goals. It's funny because soccer, hockey, football, even getting home in baseball, it's all about getting someplace. And we have to start looking at goals. It's cliche as it is, but I want to challenge everyone to start looking at your goals for next year. What are your year's goals? Change the top to 2020. What do you want to accomplish by the end of 2020? Well, then you got to zoom in a little bit and say, okay, so what needs to happen in the next 90 days to get me closer to those year's goals? But then let's zoom in a little bit more and say, what needs to happen in the next 30 days to get me closer to those goals? You know, football teams like Florida Gators or the Ohio State Buckeyes here in Columbus where I live, or the Buffaloes out where you live, Eric, you know, they don't set out to win the national championship. They usually set out to win their conference, because if they don't win their conference, there's probably almost no chance they're going to win the national championship. So they zoom in and focus, and then they say, let's win today's game. If we can win today's game, there's a better chance we can make it to the conference title. And then I want to challenge everybody, live your life, let real estate happen in the cracks. You've got to have some personal goals in there as well. Those could be physical. Those could be monetary. Those could be something to do with your family, your community, the charities you work in, other businesses, your house, whatever it might be. But when you have some goals, I think it makes a ton of sense. Let's talk about basketball. Eric, I'm a big basketball fan, especially college basketball. College basketball season's getting ready to kick off here in the next few weeks. The pro season started last week. The lesson I want people to learn from basketball comes from one of my favorite coaches of all time. That was Dean Smith. And he used to run what was called the four-corner offense. And that was basically a way that at the end of the game to keep his lead by extending his players across the floor. Well, I want to share my four-corner offense that I've put into play. Eric, when I jumped back into real estate in August of 2016, I needed to do what I taught agents to do every day. And that was put seeds in the ground to start building relationships and solving problems and having fun every day. And so I created what I called the 4-H Club. And the 4-H Club for me means this: every day when I go in the office, every day I get in the office early in the morning, the first thing I do is I do five handwritten notes. That's my first H. I do five handwritten notes to people in my sphere of influence, clients, potential clients, anyone who I have a relationship with, people in my sphere of influence or in my CRM. The second H is I do a hot sheet. And I run the hot sheet for my town in the MLS so I can see what listings have hit the market, what price changes, what sales, and what closings have happened. Now, Eric, if I know somebody that lives within a 2-block radius of any of those houses on that list, I call them, I text them, or I email them to let them know about that property. Whether it's my listing or not, I just call to give them an update on the real estate in their neighborhood. After I do that, I run my happy birthdays. I jump onto Facebook and see which of my friends had birthdays today. And I send them a message or I send them a video text message just to stand out and greet them. And then I do what's called my high fives. That's my fourth H. And my high fives, I'm already on Facebook after I did my happy birthday. So I do five likes, I do five comments. I go over to Twitter and I do five comments or retweets. I jump onto Instagram and I do five comments on Instagram, either on people's stories or on their posts. And then I send five random text messages. So that's 25 touches in my high fives. Now, Eric, once I've done that for the day, I walk across the parking lot to Starbucks and I get my morning coffee. Now, let me go back a slide, Eric. So 500 notes. Let's just say three people that I talked to from the hot sheet report. 12 birthdays, let's say today, and 25 touches. Eric, let me ask you a question. If you did 45 touches every day before your morning coffee, do you think you'd build some business down the road with that?
Absolutely.
Yeah. And how many of those 45
Absolutely.
touches, how many of those were real estate related? Only the hot sheets, right? Only the hot sheets were real estate related. So it's just a chance for me to get in front of somebody, to get my name, to get what I do, who I am in front of them. And so maybe that day, that week, the next month, when they think real estate, they think me. And so it's just been a really great way for me to make sure I'm putting seeds in the ground every day. Farmers don't just wake up and say, I want to be a farmer today. They have to put seeds in the ground. They have to fertilize the land. They have to till the soil. They have to water and fertilize and wait and be patient. And so every day I do my 4-H Club. And I'm hoping a lot of people took pictures of that or wrote that down because that, Eric, has been really one of the keys to my success getting back up and running since I jumped back into sales. It's just something that it's part of who I am, part of what I do now.
Well, I can attest to it because I get a video text message definitely for my birthday, but about once a quarter from you. So I love what you do.
And it stands out to you, right? Because you don't get a lot of video text messages.
Absolutely. It's the only video text message I get on my birthday is you.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Hey, so let's talk baseball. Baseball's a we're in the World Series right now. A lot of activity, excitement. Boy, I'm excited to watch the game tonight. First time World Series ever been in Washington, D.C. Here's a couple lessons from baseball, Eric. The importance of spring training. Boy, the basics are so important. We call it spring training in baseball, Grapefruit League, or Cactus League, but it's basics. It's the best players in the world showing up to practice the basics: throwing, catching, hitting, sliding, bunting, all the basics. And how neat is it that tonight, before the World Series, the best two teams left in baseball will show up 2 hours before the game and they will practice throwing and catching and running and bunting, the best players in the world. I love the quote, Eric, Yo-Yo Ma, the famous cellist. Someone asked him, they said, you're the best cellist in the world, yet you practice every day. Why do you practice every day? He says, I practice every day because I'm the best cellist in the world. But more importantly, I'm the best cellist in the world because I practice every day. And I think that's so important. Everybody should know who this is. I'm sure we have some people on here that don't. This is Willie Mays, one of the arguably the top five baseball players of all time. Willie Mays was what was called a five-tool player. He could run for speed. He had great arm strength. He could field the ball. He could hit for average, and he could hit for power. So he could get lots of singles and doubles, but he could also hit triples and home runs. Five-tool players are more valuable in the game of baseball. Right now in Major League Baseball today, there's very, very few what I would call five-tool players. Mike Trout with the Angels is one of them. Bryce Harper with the Phillies is one of them. Very few. There's a lot of four-tool players. There's a lot of three-tool players. But very, very few five-tool players. So here's the analogy to real estate. Are you a five-tool agent? Can you prospect like the best of them? Is your transaction service the top of the top? Are you great at property marketing? When you get listings, can you expose that house to the largest market possible through the best means possible? Is your client follow-up the best of the best? And how's your personal marketing? And I think it's so importantly critical, Eric, that when we think about property marketing and personal marketing, I like to say AM is PM. AM is PM. All marketing is personal marketing. All marketing is personal marketing. So the way you market a property is going to show also how you market yourself. The way you do your social media is going to show you how you market yourself. The way you, how clean of a car you drive and the way you dress and your voicemail and your first impressions, everything is marketing. But here's the question. A lot of people on this webinar are good at all these things. They're not great at all these things. They may be great at two of them or three of them, but very few agents in this industry, I think, are great at all of them. All-star level. And much like a five-tool player, a five-tool agent is more valuable. They're going to get more business. They can charge a higher commission. They're going to get more repeat and referral business. They're going to get more opportunities. And so maybe if you're not great at all five of these, maybe you start building a team around this. I'm good at 1, 2, and 3. Eric's good at 4 and 5. Let's work together. Now, as you start looking at these things, and you say, boy, in 2020, I really need to up my prospecting game. Because if I just tripled my opportunities, I'd be better. And while I agree that that could be good, let me ask you a question, Eric. If you tripled the number of opportunities you had, might that impact your service that you're able to give?
If you're not planning correctly, absolutely.
Yeah. If all of a sudden you had 25 more buyers that wanted to see houses, your service level may go down. If you all of a sudden triple your number of listings, your property marketing may have to change, your client follow-up. So be very careful that just because you have one doesn't mean that you're going to obviously impact the others, but all ships big and small rise and fall with the tides. And so obviously one can make the others critically better. Very quickly, auto racing, we're going to just hit on that one. And I love, first of all, you know, when you look at this picture with NASCAR, they are great at recognizing their team members. They're great at recognizing their sponsors and the people that helped them. To the realtors on this call, please remember the people that are on your team, your staff at your office, your manager, your company leadership, your lenders, your title partners, your home inspectors, and the other people in the business, your insurance people that help you. Every time you see someone win a NASCAR race, the first person they do is they thank their team members. And so that's important. But also this one, talk about IRL or open wheel racing. Racing, people make their money on the turn. All these men and women can drive fast when it's a straightaway. In real estate, everyone can be good in a good market. But when the markets change, when the turns happen, that's where the accidents happen. And in racing, it's the people that can navigate their way around those turns, through the traffic and through the explosions and through the car crashes to be successful. And so I don't know when it's going to happen. Eric, you don't know when it's going to happen. Our market will shift. Our market will change at some point. We've been on a very long straightaway for the last, I don't know, 10 or 12 years. And so it's probably going to change at some point here. The best people are going to make their way in the turn and navigate through that. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
All right. A couple more, and then we're going to see if we got some Q&A and then get people off to their weekend. Boy, I love this lesson from sports gambling because, admit it or not, gambling and the money line has become a huge part of sports. It's what's allowed TV to pay so much. It's what's allowed cities like Las Vegas and Atlantic City and really a lot of places around the country to grow. And It's because those guys in Vegas, they know their numbers so well. It's critical that you run your business like a business, but you got to know your numbers. The first two things I'm going to show you are super basic, but just like we talked about with baseball players, going back to the basics, every agent on this call should be able to do this almost without thinking. An analysis of their market, they should know what the residential listings look like, how's that compared to last year, what's the total. I mean, we should be looking at our numbers all the time because that is the that's the function of our market, right? It's the doctor doing his rounds in the morning. And each morning, the doctor, he or she will walk to see their patients and they'll check on the test results and they'll see how the patient did overnight and is the medicine working properly. Well, we as realtors should know our test results on a regular basis. We should constantly be keeping our finger on the pulse. If you're a new agent, this should be something you spend your entire first 30 days on. It's just deep diving and learning your market and the numbers. Because when someone says to you, how's the market? They're not talking about the national market. They're talking about right here in Mayberry RFD, what is the market here locally doing? And when you can answer those questions with confidence. And here's another one. How about a neighborhood or subdivision report? Simple, basic, but when you can do this for your subdivision, the three subdivisions around yours, the six subdivisions around those, the 12 subdivisions around those, that will help you also answer how's the market, which is the number one question we get as realtors. And so deep diving in and hey, listen, if you don't know some of these answers, ask fellow agents, ask some of your affiliate partners, go to City Hall and dig into the records and find some things out. Call your local schools, call your parish, find out address 1234 Elm Street. What elementary school does it go to? What middle school? What high school? And remember, those are a lot of times they're changing as cities grow and as zones redistrict, that could change. But that's just one piece of knowing the numbers, Eric, when it comes to gambling and sports. This is a report that I got to tell you, every agent should be trying to get their hands on. The new one's going to come out in about another, I don't know, 18 or so days when the National Association of Realtors has their conference in San Francisco. This is one of the pieces that I dive into over the holidays to get ready for the new year. And that's the NAR Home Buyer and Seller Profile, because it will really give us the information about what our buyers and sellers are doing. And I just want to share a couple things in here that I find fascinating. This one, Eric, they asked buyers, how did a buyer find their agent? So a buyer going into a house last year in 2018, how did they find their agent? And you can see there, 41% were referred by or is a friend, neighbor, or relative. 12% used the agent before to buy a house. 5% were referred by another agent. 5% met them in an open house, so there was some sort of a relationship started. And then 2% were referred by an employer or relocation company. In other words, Eric, 65% of every buyer found their agent through a relationship. Through a relationship. And that's really important to understand. Now, they ask a few more questions on this report. It's a great report, but they ask people, would you use the same
Time out,
agent?
time out.
Yep.
That 12% fat.
What's that?
I hate that 12%. I hate that 12%.
They used the agent previously?
Yeah, I should be way
Yeah.
higher.
Oh yeah, it is. And watch when I see it. Now, understand, Eric, a lot of these might be first-time home buyers. So that could skew the
That's
numbers quite a
true.
bit. If you look at first-time home buyers, only 3% used the agent before, which I don't understand how that's possible. But I'm gonna come back to that number, Eric, so I'm glad you brought that up. Now they asked the buyers. Now remember, these are buyers that went into a house last year. So we sold them a house last year. 74% of those buyers said they would definitely use the agent again. 16% said they would probably use the agent again. So the fact is 90% either definitely or probably would use the agent again. That's great. 90% are definitely or probably going to use Eric Sachs again when they go to sell. Now, let's look at this. The sellers, they ask the sellers the same questions. Would you use the agent again? To the sellers, the people that sold last year, 69% said definitely. I would definitely use Eric again. 17% said probably. So what's that? 86% said they would definitely or probably use the agent again, right? Now here's the sad thing, Eric. When they asked sellers, how did you choose the agent? Only 24 used the agent from before.
Yeah, that's
Remember
terrible.
three slides ago, 90% of buyers said they would definitely or probably use the agent again. But when they asked the sellers, how did you pick your agent? Only 24% used the agent from before. So let's talk about that, Eric. Why do you think that is?
We're bad at keeping in touch with our sphere and past clients.
I think that's a big part of it. Now, here's the thing, though. I will defend our industry. I think our industry does a good job of keeping in touch. Look, we send out e-newsletters. We send out change the clock cards. We send out social media touches. Here's what I really think the issue is. 1, 7, 12 years later, I think when that buyer that we sold the house to is time to be a seller, they have a better relationship with somebody else. See, sending a magnet once a year, sending a generic email newsletter 3 times or 4 times a year, sending a recipe.
It's the what?
That doesn't build a relationship. Eric, I don't know where you bought your car, but I bet the dealership still sends you stuff. But does the sales rep who sold you the car keep in touch with you? Probably not. So we can do a good job of sending stuff, but please don't think that keeps the relationship going. We've got to call on birthdays. We've got to stop by the neighborhood. We've got to visit with them. We've got to keep that relationship so that number goes up. Now, I'm sure there's people listening to us right now, Eric, saying like, not me. I get 90% of repeat and referral business. And that's great. That's great if you do. Continue to do that. But for the rest of the people on the call, there's a huge opportunity in those numbers. Because while you may be doing good, and to the new agents on this call, even better, because that means that 76 out of 100 people that bought a house in the last 10 years are not going to use their agent that they used before when it comes time to sell. That's an opportunity for you. For those of you that sold a bunch of houses in the last 10 or 12 years, we got to close that gap. We have to make sure that more people remember us and keep a relationship with us. Huge piece of our business. It's not about keeping in touch. It's about keeping a relationship going and growing. And the last thing, Eric, before we take some questions, and I'd love for you guys, if you have some questions, to type them in, and Eric and the crew will sift through those. Let's finish by talking about coaching. I'm a big believer in coaching. I work with some agents around the country, and I don't coach really, Eric. I like to tell people I consult. I help people make better decisions, think creatively, come up with better strategies and things like that. But coaches like Tom Landry, and arguably, you can't really argue with this one, Don Shula is one of the greatest coaches of all time. He's the only coach to ever lead a team to an undefeated season. The 1972 Miami Dolphins, 17-0. Right? And we certainly have some great coaches in our game right now. But I love Don Shula's 24-hour rule. Don Shula, the leader of men, the best coach arguably in the NFL history, had what he called the 24-hour rule. And the 24-hour rule is basic. He just said this: gentlemen, after a win or after a loss, we have 24 hours to think about it. And then on Tuesday, we start focusing on the next game. So you can stick out your chest and be cocky all you want over getting a new listing or winning a game. And you can complain and moan and cry because a buyer decided to buy a FSBO, or a listing went with another agent because they gave them a higher price or a lower fee. But we can't waste our lives worrying about deals that are gone, games that are over. So I love this philosophy that you have 24 hours to celebrate or commiserate, but then we've got to get on to the next day, the next opportunity, the next buyer, the next seller, the next referral, the next lead, and just move on. And I think if you do that, if you follow all the things we talked about, and at the end of your game, you hit the showers and you follow the instructions on that little shampoo bottle in your hand that says lather, rinse, repeat, right? If you just do the things over and over and over again, I think you'll make it into the Hall of Fame. And that can be defined however you want. But I think it's important that we think about those things there. And so while I raced through a lot of things, Eric, it still to me boils down to building relationships, solving problems, and having fun and finding ways to do that. So why don't I just maybe stop right here and see if there's any questions that people might have about anything we covered. I know we covered a ton, and I know my audio dropped for a couple seconds. I'm not sure why, but Eric, I think you're probably fired up, ready to go out and hit the field, aren't you?
Yeah. I just played hockey last night, so I can't walk any today. So the older I get, the harder it is to hit the field. But I will say this. I have some people asking if we could provide so, you know, Breakthrough Broker, we have a ton of content. They love your reports. A couple people said, would we provide copies of your reporting? Would you be okay with that?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, the neighborhood and the market reports.
Yeah, the market reports, neighborhood reports, and then how you were tracking your business.
Yeah, I will send that as a sample. I'll send it to you as a sample. It's just a blank Excel spreadsheet, but it's got the formulas built in for the days on the market, the average sales price, and the price you know, your average sales price. I think so. It's just a blank formula, but I'll get that over to you, Eric. No problem.
Get that to Natalie, and we'll put that on the site as a download when we send this out.
Love it.
Maybe not today, everybody, when we send the recording out, but we will get that out. Oh, the calendar too, Sue says, and a copy of the calendar. We'll get that stuff out to on the Breakthrough Broker site. Attached to the page of this webinar. That might take us a week or so, guys, but we'll get the webinar back out to you this afternoon.
Okay.
What other questions do you guys have for Sean? I love the mindset. I think it's fantastic for everybody to think this way in their business. Again, whether you're a top producer or you're new or you're with a big company or a small company, there are certain aspects of the business and mentality and mindset that we tend to forget. I think there's too many classes and there's too much focus at the local educational opportunities across the country. Everybody's focusing on lead gen and everybody's focusing on social media and some very strategic technical aspects of our business. And we forget some of the fundamental mindsets that help us succeed. And those of you on the call that look at these top producers or mega producers or these your top 1%ers in your individual marketplace, I think it's super important to understand that this is their mindset. This is what they live every day. And so let's not get so wrapped up in the minutia and start to realize that there are some fundamental mindsets that we need to look at our business and treat our business this way that will help us be successful. So Sean, yeah, I'm so happy.
Eric, let me jump in and tag on that, because once again, a lot of the top producers around the country, they're that, you know, they're the major league level, you know, equivalent, and they focus mm-hmm. on the basics. They do the basics mm-hmm. really, really well. It's so amazing to me when people say, you know, I'm going to wait, and in January, I'm going to get back to the basics. Listen, if the basics work so well, we should never have to get back to them. We should just do them every day. That's why I think the 4-H Club for me is so critical, because it just every single day before I get distracted by the minutiae of the business or chase the shiny opportunities, I put seeds in the ground every single day.
Tell us what those four H's were again.
So I do the handwritten notes. 5 handwritten notes goes out first. Then the hot sheet, so I just run the hot sheet for my town in my MLS. Then I do my happy birthdays. So I go on to Facebook and see which of my
out.
Friends.
A hot sheet is new listings every day.
Yes. So the new listings, the price changes in contracts. Then I do my happy birthdays and then my high fives. That's the last H, and that's 5 likes on Facebook. So I scroll through my feed and like 5 things. I do 5 comments on Facebook. I do 5 comments on Instagram. Let me pause there, guys. It's so easy on Instagram just to scroll through your feed and like things. But think about this. At the end of the day, when you've posted the picture and you have 87 likes and 3 comments, what do you pay attention to? The comments. In fact, the comments, you're going to like the comment and comment on the comment. So you can really hijack people's mind share when you comment. So I do 5 comments on Instagram. I do 5 comments or retweets on Twitter. And then I send 5 random text messages to 5 different people, not 5 to 1 person. So that could be a funny GIF. It could be a have a great day, Eric, or congrats on the Avalanche you know, victory over the Blue Jackets last night, or hey, are you going to be at the hockey rink this weekend? Just a little touch, because we all know when our phone vibrates, we look at it. And so for that split second, I can capture people's mind share, and they know Sean Carpenter real estate, Sean Carpenter speaker, Sean Carpenter beer drinker, Sean Carpenter golfer, Sean Carpenter father, husband, whatever it may be.
How do you get a question? How do you get the NAR report?
So the NAR report,
no, I'm just
kidding. if you're a National Association of Realtor member, that report will come out it comes out in conjunction with the conference, which is a couple weeks away. You can go on realtor.org and you can order it right there from the store. I believe you can get the PDF download for, I think, like $19, maybe it's $29, or I'm not sure what it is. Or your broker can probably provide it for you. So a lot of times.
Yeah. And it costs money to download from NAR. And so ask your broker to get it and they can make copies and give it to you guys.
Yep.
That would be my opinion. But all the brokers on the call are hanging up right now.
Yeah, right. Well, hey, listen, Eric, if you want, it's, It's one of my favorite things I do. Maybe we'll if the feedback was good on this, we'll jump back on in January and we'll dissect that report and break it down.
I think it's a fantastic idea. I love that idea. Some a couple of people are asking, where do you get the hot sheets? Guys, you got to go to your local MLS, and there are in your MLS settings, there should be run a report for new listings, price changes, or updates. So it's different. You know, there's 800 MLSs across the country. We're probably represented by all 800 on this call. So, guys, you just got to go to your MLS and
yeah,
figure
and guys,
that out.
I don't look at all of Columbus, Ohio. There's 1.4 million people here. I look at my city, my little neighborhood, Upper Arlington, Ohio, and I just have it set to email me every morning the newest listing. So if I get emailed, Eric, every morning at 8 o'clock, then tomorrow's report is going to show anything that's come in after 8 o'clock in the morning when that last email went out. So I'm only looking at the freshest information.
I love that. And then, so Paul's asking what you're doing with the hot sheet. So Paul, remember the hot sheet is part of his 4 H's. And so he looks at the hot sheet, and if there's a home in the hot sheet that corresponds to somebody he knows in his sphere of influence, he'll call and let them know that that's for sale in the neighborhood, right? Correct, Sean?
Yeah, Eric.
The hot sheet.
Let's kind of play this out. Let's say that you're a friend of mine. I live in, you know, you live in my town or I live in yours. And this morning I wake up and I see there's a new listing in Centennial. And as I see that house on Waco Boulevard, I say, hey, that's the same neighborhood Eric lives in. So I'm either going to call you or text you or email you right through the MLS. Just a quick note that says, Eric, hey, just want to let you know the house around the corner from you just hit the market. Let me know if you have questions, period. P.S. You want to catch a beer this weekend and watch the game. So it's super. It's not, do you want to buy it? Do you know someone that wants to buy it? It's just, I just want to let Eric know that I'm keeping him up to date with what's going on in the area. A small, simple touch, text, email, or phone call that is now going to make, listen, if Eric calls me up and says, hey, Carp, I thought that was a XYZ listing or a Slippery Slope listing. Oh, it is, Eric. I didn't want you to think it was my listing. I just want to let you know it was available or it was on the market. And I just want Eric, when he hangs up, to say, yeah, Sean really knows what's going on in our neighborhood. Because chances are the XYZ or Slippery Slope agent didn't call you, didn't tell you.
Yeah, and that makes you be the expert. All right, guys, I got to cut it off. We will have Sean with us in 2020, hopefully as much as he wants to be. We'll have him on quite a bit. For everybody, what's coming up? We will have 2020 business planning, November and December, live 2020 business planning. Get your groups, get your brokerages. There's limited space on those. So remember, only 1,000 on a call. So get signed up, get on them early. Again, live 2020 business planning. You will leave that webinar with your 2020 business plan done and in hand. So keep an eye out for our business planning workshops over the next couple weeks. Guys, thank you so much. Sean, I can't thank you enough. Have a fantastic weekend. We'll do, guys, keep your eyes open for stuff from Sean on Breakthrough Broker. Anyone on this call that hasn't liked BreakthroughBroker.com on Facebook, like us. You'll see all our new content first on our Facebook page. So everybody have a great weekend, and we will talk soon. Thanks, everybody.